If you had to make a playlist of your life, what would be on it? The music of your childhood? The backbeats of your teens? The music that always makes you cry or fills you with joy? And if, toward the end of your life, your mind and memories were fading away, would this soundtrack help bring them back? In this episode, we're going to show you a remarkable program that is bringing personalised music to people with dementia.
Everybody up.
Waking up their inner lives.
I was stunned at the conversation that she had post the music.
And even helping people with advanced Parkinson's to unfreeze and move. And along the way, we'll look more deeply at the power of music in all our lives. Why is it so emotional, so memorable, and so powerful that even when much of the brain is gone, music can bring it alive? This is Lee Place Aged Care Home, and this is John. He used to be in the Navy, but he doesn't remember much of that now, or much of anything. But next door, a prescription is being prepared they hope will peel back the dementia fog.
So we've got John's playlist.
Only it's not a pill, it's an iPod with a tailor-made playlist just for him.
Can I just pop these headphones on you? Yeah.
The residents are about to hear some of their favourite music, and for some, it'll be the first time they've heard it in years.
You ready?
The change is startling, instant. This facility is one of the first in Australia to take on a new program of personalised music called Music and Memory. And for John, it's clearly taking him back.
You know what they call that song?
Which song? This one just now?
It's A Long Way to Tickle Mary.
To Tickle Mary.
Somehow it's like a side door into the brain, and it just means that they can come alive for that moment.
Yeah? When you were in the ships in the Navy, did you sing that song?
Yeah.
Yeah?
And when those memories come flooding back, it's connecting them with identity again.
Next, it's Mary's turn, and her son Doug is visiting specially to see what happens.
Mum was a product of the Hunter Valley. Around Aberdeen.
But you got to say, you're not my husband and I'm not your wife.
That's right.
You might have been thinking that.
Yeah. What relation am I to you?
Well, I was just trying to work it out. You're not my father.
No. I'm your son.
Oh, he's my son. Isn't that awful?
No, that's life.
It's the first time they're trying the personal music with Mary, and Doug helped choose the playlist.
And you do that too. I love dancing.
The program is really new here, and the sheer emotional impact is taking everyone by surprise.
Your turn.
When I was watching Mum react the way she did, it looked like...
It's not easy, is it?
Mum evolved.
I love dancing. I love running. I was...
What we find is people with dementia, they start to withdraw into themselves. So what we're finding with the music and memory program is the music allows them to reconnect with their family member.
It was good to hear you sing.
That ability to reconnect husbands with wives, sons and daughters with their mum or dad is just a fantastic thing. It's very, very powerful.
I'm having a real happy night. That's I'm very happy, yeah.
We've had to order more tissues in.
Then we will say goodbye and part. I'll always keep you in my heart.
The idea of bringing personalised music to people with dementia is catching on across the globe. And one of the people introducing it in Australia is former nurse turned director of the Arts Health Institute, Dr. Maggie Hirsch.
Oh, thank you. I think that music is actually a human right. Music predates language. There's something very primal about music. Now, if we're able to access our music when we're growing up through the generations, why is it that we can't get music when we need it most? And now we absolutely need to make sure that music, in this such a simple way, is able to be accessible in healthcare environments.
And the science is suggesting there's more to it than just the emotional feel-good factor. In its best studied benefit, researchers from Stanford University, California, have shown prescribed music can reduce one of the more distressing aspects of Alzheimer's, agitation, where confused, stressed individuals act out or shout.
Bang.
It may even reduce the need for antipsychotics, often prescribed for agitation.
So, for example, John, he has limited mobility. He shouldn't really be getting out of his chair by himself. And sometimes if he's agitated, he'll be trying up and down out of the chair. So instead of the staff having to constantly come over to John, reassure him, ask him to sit down again, we can put the headphones on. He's relaxed, he's calm, he's at peace. It's fantastic, better than drugs.
So the right playlist can penetrate even the thickest fog of dementia, which begs the question, how? The fact is, music does something to our brains no other stimulus can do. And here at the Music, Sound and Performance Lab, we're going to show you.
So the main thing is to take off all the metal. We need to get all the metal off your body.
My examiners are Professor Mark Williams and Professor Bill Thompson, a world expert on music and emotions, as well as a composer himself.
So you've chosen a couple of pieces of music to listen to. Do you want to say anything about those?
I've chosen a piece from The Mission that I really love, and another piece by a group called Train.
As far as we're aware, this is the first time scientists have ever tried to show real-time brain responses to favourite music in a magnetoencephalography machine. So we're all a bit nervous to see if it works. As the music starts, my mind is flooded with memories. A Tuscan hillside, an old church, a moment shared with a loved one. And with it comes overwhelming emotion. Now this piece is completely different. It fills me with joy. I'm struggling to stay still. Hey, soul sister,
hey, Mr. on the radio, stereo, the way you... She's blinking a lot during the pauses.
Right.
Many repeats later, I'm finally released.
Congratulations, you did it.
A bit shattered after that, actually.
So here are the results, which have been really exciting because we've got lots of activation to each of the pieces. We've got these emotional areas here in the front of the brain. The mission piece is much more involved in the emotion areas. We've also got a lot of activation here on the temporal lobe, which is more for memories of emotions, and the amygdala, which is involved in physiological responses to emotion.
Wow.
But also a lot of motor areas. So these are the areas involved in moving your hands. And the interesting thing is that between the two different pieces, we got very different activations. One much more involved in emotions and one much more involved in actually moving to the motor areas.
Wow, that's fantastic, because I mean, I could feel that. I'm amazed that you can actually see that so clearly on the brain.
Yeah, and it's very strong.
This is what we were hoping to see. It shows what's unique about music in the brain. It's embedded nearly everywhere, from emotional centres to memory centres to movement. And that helps explain why, even when much of the brain is gone, music can wake it up.
It's like a super stimulus. So much of your brain is involved that I think that that means that there's more opportunity for the effects of music to be preserved in the face of damage.
So that's why music is so powerful. But I want to know, why is it so emotional? And why does some music conjure joy and others make us cry?
The piece from The Mission is a really powerful piece, and I think there's a lot going on there. I think the oboe has a kind of voice-like quality, a crying voice, a sad and melancholy vocalization. And you have empathy for that kind of yearning sound of the melody. The other aspect of The Mission is it's quite a slow tempo. So it's got a lot of the qualities that would generate a kind of sad or calm feeling.
Slow music calms our physiology down. Faster music invites it to speed up, which is why so many of us use it for exercise.
In the music train, it's much faster. The motor cortex is engaged heavily. You might be tapping along to the music, so you're literally moving. Your breathing is fast, your heart rate increases, and thereby increase your arousal levels and your energy.
The high pitch of the ukulele adds joy.
It sounds cute. There's something about instruments that sound cute that make us happy. It's like a little puppy sound.
So one of the ways music arouses our emotions is to tap into deeply hardwired responses to certain vocalizations. Across the animal kingdom, alert calls tend to be high-pitched, loud and fast. Calming signals are lower-pitched, soft and slow. The sounds convey the mood. And in humans, these basic tropes have become an entire sophisticated language of emotion.
Many people believe, myself included, that music evolved from an earlier system that was just largely an emotional form of communication, an emotional proto-language.
To get a glimpse of what that early proto-language might have been like, you only have to look here. At how a mother talks with her baby.
When infants are pre-linguistic, all they have is your tone of voice. So pitch is used much more in early speech.
So back in prehistory, at some point, this proto-language split into language, which carried more information, and music, which continued to carry the messages of emotion. That is the deep reason music remains so viscerally emotional. But there's another role that music played in our evolutionary past, a role without which we may not even have evolved into humans.
it's all about bonding.
We need about a mil of spit.
These saliva samples are so that we can test levels of oxytocin. Oxytocin is known as the cuddle chemical. It's the bonding hormone, the one that's released when we interact with our loved ones. So what produces more of this highly specific bonding chemical? Milling around with friends or singing together? We're recreating a German study that was published in 2014. It showed for the first time that singing together nearly doubled the oxytocin released as just interacting with friends. And our little test was similar.
I was very impressed with the amount that it went up. The levels that we achieved were the same as the European study in the after samples.
It's just one of a series of studies since 2010 that have shown a powerful physiological effect of music on social bonding. Taken together, these studies have convinced one of the world's foremost evolutionary biologists that without music, we never would have become human at all.
Music really, in many ways, just fundamental to our ability to hold together large communities of individuals.
Our pre-human ancestors bonded their groups by grooming, which releases endorphins and oxytocin, hormonally cementing social bonds. But there are only so many monkeys you can groom in a day. To reach the large group size that made humanity so successful, we needed to evolve something bigger, something better, something that would create bonding oxytocin on a mass scale. And that, according to Professor Dunbar, 500,000 years ago, was music.
Means you can groom with lots of individuals simultaneously. In fact, probably it's almost unlimited the number of individuals you can have in a singing group or a dancing group. Music is absolutely pivotal in the course of human evolution.
So music evolved as a means of sharing emotions and forging powerful social bonds. But of course, you can't talk about music's impact on our brains without also talking about movement. From just as soon as we can move, we want to move to music. It's irresistible, it's innate. We pick up the rhythm and run with it. And it's an ability that simply doesn't exist in even our closest animal relatives. In this experiment, monkeys are trained to tap to a beat, and it's not easy for them. This monkey took a year to learn to tap in time with his hand. But look more closely at what he's doing. He's not actually tapping on the beat, he's tapping fractionally after. He's using the sound as a cue, and as soon as it stops, he stops. Compare that with what we humans do.
Okay, I would like to try now a little experiment. So we're going to play a couple of bars of music. Just click your fingers whenever you think you should. You ready?
We take this ability for granted, but what just happened is extraordinary. Within two bars, everyone was on beat. But what's more incredible is that these two beats aren't even being played in the music. The only place we can hear those missing beats is in our heads.
I think the point is made.
So what we do is called entrainment. Our brains pick up on that beat instantly, and then we hold it in mind so that we have the beat going in our mind, and then we are able to synchronize our movements to that beat.
Neuroscientist and pianist Professor Jessica Groen has made it her life's work to understand why music and movement are connected in the brain.
If we think about the conditions that had to have existed when music evolved, there were no phones, there were no Walkmans, there were no record players. If you wanted music, you had to make it yourself. And there was no way to make music without moving.
Our brains even adapt the rhythm of our brainwaves to the rhythm of the beat.
We use EEG, electroencephalography, to record the firing and the responses of neurons. You can see that they are firing and pulsing in exactly the same way that the music that someone is listening to is. Even more interestingly, you can actually see that two people playing the same music often show some synchrony between their brain waves.
So as we evolved from primate to human, there was a fundamental change in our brains that made us musical. As well as rejigging our emotional centres, it involved rejigging our motor systems. And that is why music is now being used to do something almost beyond belief. Helping people who are freezing in space to unfreeze and move. John has Parkinson's. It's an insidious disease that attacks the parts of the brain that allow movement.
In my case, I have this shuffle where I start to walk too fast and I can't sort of stop myself. And so I have to be very careful. Well, not to do a face plant, really.
Here at the Human Movement Lab, Professor Meg Morris has spent years analysing these movement problems and trying to find a way to help.
For reasons unknown, there's a lack of dopamine in the brain, and dopamine normally allows movements to be performed large and fast, and balance is affected as well. So what John has, you can see here, is a freezing of gait, and the feet are sticking to the floor.
But watch what happens when we start the music.
Beautiful to watch.
It is, it's so beautiful. And for a person who is shuffling and blocking and freezing, to be moving like that. So what we think music does is to bypass the defective basal ganglia to activate what's trapped inside. So the music provides an external rhythm to compensate for the defective rhythm inside the brain.
Meg has been a pioneer of this therapy. And it's incredible to watch. I see people who never get a break from feeling trapped by their inability to control their own body's movement until the music comes in. And the movement begins to flow, and with joy, they can dance.
If you can give a person with Parkinson's a joy, that's a gift.
So music is hardwired to make us move, to make us feel. But why is it also such a powerful evoker of memories?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Part of it is sheer repetition.
Happy birthday.
Not only do we hear it verbatim, over and over and over again in a way that's unique and doesn't happen with speech, but we also imagine music, so we hear it in our heads, and sometimes music can even get stuck in our heads. For those reasons, it becomes deeply ingrained or tattooed into the mind.
But music doesn't just groove itself easily into our memories, it carries other memories with it. Shane was severely brain injured in a bike accident. He's had an amazing recovery, but 4 years ago, when neuropsychologist Dr. Amy Baird met him, he was struggling to speak, move, or remember. Music helped give him his past.
All right.
What about that one? Is that familiar?
That is. It really is. My sister. It reminds me of my sister. She's always listening to that song. And
Shane was part of a study to see if music could evoke memories even with people with severe brain injury. And surprisingly, they did as well as the healthy people.
The other really interesting finding was that when we compared asking a question, like, can you tell me a memory from your school days, versus playing them a song from their school days, the songs were much more efficient at bringing to mind personal memories.
So why is music so much more potent than words at evoking memories? Well, as we saw during my musical journey inside the Meg machine, unlike any other stimulus, it arouses most of the brain. But in particular, it all comes back to our emotions and how emotion and memory are intertwined.
I think that is why music is so powerful, because it activates both the memories and emotions simultaneously almost.
And of course, that is why everyone's favourite music is so deeply personal. It's a deeply grooved record of the times that mattered to us and the people we have loved. This is the Redleaf Manor Aged Care Home. It's just taken on the Music and Memory Project. They've spent weeks preparing some personalised playlists, and it's finally time to try them.
This is the first day for Music and Memory, so I'm really excited to see what actually will happen.
First is Betty, who's developed advanced dementia.
Comfortable for you?
Yes.
To her family's sadness, Betty now holds little of who she was. She's become very confused and withdrawn. She rarely smiles or shows any emotion at all, until right now.
Mountains green, the holy Lamb of God on England's breast.
I was stunned at the conversation that she had post the music. So it was actually a coherent conversation. It wasn't muddled. And I didn't expect that to happen.
And North Jerusalem is the
hill. They bring home a feeling of happiness.
Awestruck, I should think it'd be. Surely.
I can't say any more, otherwise it'd burst out crying.
Really? Why?
Even though Betty was crying, I think she was crying because she was... she felt herself. And if this program can do that, isn't that a great link to past, but still capturing the essence of the person?
Anyway, I'll stop being stupid now.
You're not stupid.
Not at all.
No. Thank
music,
you.
Music is emotional.
We have it for you to listen to all the time.
And I think the more you love the music, the more you love the feeling.
It seems such an obvious thing. After a life surrounded by our favourite music, why would we not want that to continue as long as possible?
I'm happy.
Music is the soundtrack to our lives.
There's such a lot of world to see. We're after the same.